Good morning, boys and girls. So this morning, I want you to take some time to think about who your best friend is. This is one of my best friends, and she's also my sister, so you guys probably know her as Auntie Diana. Well, every time something happy or funny happens in our lives, we always tell each other. And even when we're sad or angry, we talk to each other to seek comfort. And I bet you guys do the same things with your best friends. And that's because we have something that's called a relationship. So God also wants us to have a relationship with Him, and we can do that by talking to Him every day through our prayers. And today I wanted to tell you guys about some different ways that we can pray. So one of the first ways to pray is by praising Him. So that's when we tell God how much we love Him. And in the Bible, there was a king named Jehoshaphat who actually prayed to God because he needed help when he was about to go to war with some of these big armies that were against him. Well, he prayed and said, "God, please help us. I'm scared and I don't know what to do." He believed that God would help him, so he actually sent some people out before the war happened to sing and praise God. God heard their praises, and he actually made those other armies so confused that they started attacking each other. So King Jehoshaphat, he didn't even have to fight. Another way we can pray is when we repent. So when we repent, that means we are asking for forgiveness for all of our mistakes. And an example in the Bible is the prodigal son. When he left his family to go do his own thing, it didn't go his way. So when it didn't go his way, he came back to his father, and his father just accepted him into the family again. He forgave him. So God is the same way, and he will always forgive us when we ask for repentance. Another way we can pray is also by asking. So in Matthew 7:7, it says, "Ask and it will be given to you." In the Bible, there's a story about a lady named Hannah, and she did just that. She couldn't have a baby, so she asked God, "God, if you please give me a baby, I'll give this baby back to you to do your work." And God heard her prayers, and he did just that. He gave her a beautiful baby boy named Samuel. And the last way we can pray is when we yield. So this means that we should listen to God and always believe in Him because He's in control. When we pray and we ask for everything, we also need to listen and obey God to see what He wants, no matter how we feel. So remember, boys and girls, to always pray to build your relationship with God. Happy Sabbath!
Our school is a very important place as it's teaching the future generation about being God's messengers. In the Bible, it says, "Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it." That is a verse that I learned when I was at Maui Adventist School and have never forgotten. We ask that you keep our school in your special prayers. Pray for all the teachers, the students, as well as the parents. And today's special music is dedicated to Maui Adventist School and preschool.
When I cried, helped me when I tried. Now I treasure every memory, 'cause I'm sure there couldn't be a child who could have known more love than what I thank you for the blessings of coming to you young. I came to love you early. I came to know you young. You touched my heart, dear Jesus, when my life had just begun. I gave you my childish heart of sin, and you saved me from a lifetime of what I might have been. I came to love you early. I came to know you young. You touched my heart, dear Jesus, when my I gave you my tomorrows and a childish heart of sin, and you saved me from a lifetime of what I might have been.
Good morning and happy Sabbath, dear friends. I would like to welcome you to the Kahului Seventh Day Adventist Church to our online service. Yes, we all have questions, and there is a lot of uncertainty. We do not know how long our services will remain online, but please know that no calamity will stop us from worshiping together to our amazing God. Today, I would like to encourage all of you and offer you the opportunity to participate with us in the Lord's Supper Communion from the comfort of your own home next Sabbath on May the 2nd, 2020. I'm going to preach and share with you about the emblems of love and invite you to participate with all of us. The online event is going to begin at 11 o'clock a.m. Hawaii Standard Time, with members from Kahului Seventh Day Adventist Church and across the whole entire world. Everyone is welcome. And I will pray with you as we will enjoy the Lord's Supper Communion together. But to prepare for this online event, please follow the following steps. Please read the Gospel of John, chapter 13, 1 through 15. Yeah, from the verse 1 until the verse 15. Read the 1 Corinthians, chapter 15, from verses 23 through 29. And especially Book of Desire of Ages, pages 642 until the page 661. If it's possible, please conduct a food washing service on your home before the service, because the ordinance of humility, this is what we call the special process, which is supposed to be prior before you will take the bread and the wine. And to prepare the bread, we will share with you the recipe to make unleavened bread. Please just look online, we will share with you. And please buy and get unfermented grape juice prior before the communion service. And remember, my dear friend, to celebrate the Lord's Supper Communion, it should be always be a sincere event when you're preparing your heart and mind. It's never tuned down experience. Wrongs have been corrected, since you already confessed all your sins and sins have been forgiven. The faith has been reaffirmed again. It is time to celebrate with our Jesus. This service will be available online on the Facebook page and on our YouTube channels from Kahului Seventh-day Adventist Church. But today, the sermon for today is titled, Has Faith Been Destroyed by the Virus? Has faith been destroyed by the virus? And the text is going to be from 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. It says, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Our merciful Heavenly Father, we are praising you for giving us amazing lessons every single day. But in a time like this, we really need you, Jesus. We need your help. We need your guidance. We need your protection. Oh, dear Lord, please help those who are already going through such a time of trouble and struggle. And for all of us who is here right now studying your word, help us to discover, help us to learn how to survive in times like this and increase our faith. Oh, dear Lord, we need you. In the name of Jesus, amen. Dear brothers and sisters, we are living in challenging times right now. Everything has changed in the world almost in the blink of an eye. Our regular, predictable way of living is gone for the time being. Life itself slowed down not only in the Hawaiian Islands, but in the whole entire world. And many people are wondering, what on earth is really going on? Everything began from the completely unexpected side of life, from the very little unnoticeable virus named Corona, which can be translated as a crown. I do wonder, whose crown is this? Is this the devil's way of trying to keep us away from the walk with God? There can be a lot of parallels between the current virus and the situation with the virus and the subject of sin. The Bible also actually shares some thoughts about this topic. For example, in the book of Romans, chapter 6, verse 23, it says, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Yeah, the whole world is united to slow down and stop the spread of this virus. Around the globe, people are quarantining themselves in their own homes. I talked to many of our friends and family members in Belgium, and in England, in Curacao, Caribbean Islands, in Russia. They are all having stressful times right now, surrounded by their four walls in their own homes. In every country, antiviral measures have been put in place. And these measures are directed at all societies, including the church. The church worship services and prayer meetings, Bible studies, all have been kind of grouped into one common package, just like everyone else who gathers at the restaurants, shopping centers, or bars or other public events. We all have been asked to stay at home. The virus of sin has infected us all. We have all been contaminated by the darkness of sin and have lost our own way. It does not matter now why people gather, if they want to come together to drink or hang out or to pray. It is a very challenging time when uplifting spiritual services and hangout parties are all considered the same as a danger to the human beings. We may not agree with all the regulations right now, but friends, let me ask you, what is the most important thing in the world, here in our planet Earth? The human life, absolutely. Each of us has an immune system made by God for us to defend us from the bacteria, from viruses, and from any other foreign pathogens. But friends, just because you feel healthy and actually symptoms-free, it does not mean what you are not at risk and are completely safe to those who are around you. Therefore, it is important for us to protect those who are at a greater risk. But as a church, we too want to save lives, not take them. Even though the churches physical doors of the churches are closed now, we are open online for prayer meetings on Wednesday nights, for Vespers on Friday nights, for Sabbath school lesson on Sabbath morning. And while you are searching online, you will find many speculations. Is this virus man-made? Did it evolve from the animal infection? I think for the believer in Jesus, it does not matter if the appearance of the virus is real or fake, man-made or from the animal origin. During our current stressful times, the most important factor in our walk, it's our personal experience and our walk with God. I encourage you not to fear, but rely on the Word of God during times like this. Today, I would like to recall the entrance of Jesus Christ into Jerusalem. It says in the book of Matthew, chapter 21, that the most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the temple and the people all around him were shouting over there at the temple. Praise God for the Son of David. Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in the highest heaven. The entire city of Jerusalem was in uproar as he entered. Who is this? They asked. And the crowds replied, it is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. As only Jesus entered into the temple, things began to happen. The Bible says, Jesus went into the temple courtyard and threw all people out, threw out everyone who was buying and selling there. He overturned the money changers and tables and their chairs and those who sold pigeons. It seems like people were sitting there and doing their normal work, temple business. They were selling sacrificial animals, since without them, there is no way to have remission of sins. People exchanged their money for those who came from overseas, and life was moving normally. So why did Jesus do that? Could it be what the faith in God has nothing to do with manipulation of selling salvation to the people? This is what Matthew says here in chapter 21, verse 13. Matthew chapter 21, verse 13, where he is saying, Scripture says, my house will be called a house of prayer, but you are turning it into a gathering place for thieves. Then the words of the Jesus turned even worse than just overturning tables. Jesus says, no one of these stones will be left on top of another. Each one will be turned down. Many years ago, I remember in Russia, since 1917 until 1989, the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, for over 70 years, persecuted the Christian church. Thousands of believers were expelled from the churches and imprisoned. people in the world are wondering what is really going on. Camp prisoners often toil through the brutal weather, sometimes facing sub-zero temperatures. Food provisions were tight and work days were long. If prisoners didn't complete their work, they received less or almost no food. During that time, the temples, the churches all over around in Russia were destroyed by the Communist Party, and the stones were not left one on top of the other. Yes, and the Seventh-day Adventists experienced unprecedented oppression. A spiritual analysis of these events is indisputable to the horror which the Christian church went through. During those days, a massive exit of people out of the churches and deprivation of faith led astray any communication and services among the people. Under total oppression and ridicule and absolute humiliation, some believers organized absolutely something unusual at those days and moments: homes of prayer. I grew up in such a home when we had a home of prayer in our society, in our place where people gathered secretly to worship God. The Lord had mercy on His people then, and I believe what He has mercy on His people now here. We are not expelled from the churches for our faith. We are not expelled from our churches on anti-revolutionary propaganda, not for disturbing public order. We are not expelled from the churches by insulting the feelings of the other believers. Not at all. We are expelled from the churches because of our love for our neighbors and friends, for our elderly, and for those who are immunocompromised, for the safety of our society. We are doing our best to serve people online, over the internet, but without the real people, without believers, our services actually loses its meaning. And now it is not the time to point fingers and blame the others. It is not the time to question our legislative authorities. It is not the time for the believers to actually complain about what is really going on with that global conspiracy, or if the virus is real or if it's fake. Now it is the time, like never before, to read the Bible, to study the Word of God, and be a diligent student of the Word which the Lord provided for the last day. Why does our Lord Jesus expel us from His church building? Why does the Lord Jesus expel me from His church building? For more than 70 years in this country, we have been calm and confident, going to church every weekend, or once or twice a year for some people, maybe just for Christmas or just Easter. We went to the church without looking back in case if someone is watching us. No, we are absolutely okay. We were not worried if someone will stop us, pointing on us automatic rifle and forbid us to believe in God or threaten our life. No, we're not worrying about our relatives. Is our relationship with them quite secure? We're even not worrying about our own ourselves, since it seems like we are planning to live forever and ever, like in the times of Noah. But in those days, this is what the Bible says, Matthew chapter 24. Those days before the flood, the people were enjoying banquets and parties and weddings right up to the time Noah entered his boat. People did not realize what was going on and what is going to happen until the flood came and swept them all away. This is the way it will be when the Son of Man comes. The Bible says what God uses circumstances to speak right now. And now it seems so obvious He is using coronavirus to speak to you and to me. And he's not just talking loud. God is screaming. I don't know about you, my dear church family, but the physical church is like a second home to me. I have grown right in the church environment, and I feel empty when I'm physically not able to attend the church. And I'm not sure, maybe I'm not alone on this. But we used to worship on Saturdays, and we had special events in the church. Lord's Supper, communions, and health programs, revival seminars. I remember choir concert and vacation Bible school. The kids were running around and enjoying the opportunities to be at the church and play and study the Bible. But our children grew up in the church, and it's not just part of their lives. It's the whole world for them. We are trying to keep them out of the sinful world. And from the story of Jesus, which we are learning here from Matthew chapter 21, those people came to self services and other goods only in the physical part of the temple. But according to Jesus, they were unnecessary for the house of prayer, since they were doing harmful work for the precious souls, for the precious people of God. Maybe we are not accustomed to having services in the church, but we lost maybe our respect and our fear, because we already so accustomed to attend the church, and now it's quite unusual time for us we're experiencing when we need to rethink about our acts. Just think about the way how we were attending the church services. Maybe we forgot about the presence of God over there and the presence of the Holy Spirit Himself. Maybe this virus is simply a wake-up call for our spiritual growth. It is very good what we all know each other. We say we love each other and what we feel like we are one big church family. But this does not give us the right to talk poorly about our neighbor behind their back. Some children were running around the church, yet not even entering the church service. Maybe just they were playing on their phones and not listening to the words of God at all. Children are running around, but parents don't care. This has been a norm in everyday life when visiting the church service. But this is not what all the words of God is telling us to do while we are practicing our worship service time to our Lord. You should know about this, Timothy says to the young boy. Paul is saying to Timothy, to the young boy, this is what is going to happen at the last days. There will be a very difficult times. And he's writing in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 through 5. This is what it says. It will be a very difficult times, for the people will love only themselves and their money. Will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and not grateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving and unforgiving. They will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. They will betray their friends, be reckless, be puffed up with pride, and love pleasure rather than God. They will act religious, but they will reject the power that could make them godly. Stay away from people like that, Apostle Paul suggests to Timothy. What do we bring to the church, and what do we take out? What spiritual fruit do we collect? For all of these weeks, I have been thinking how sinful I am. For all of this week, I've been thinking about how sinful we are. We draw great attention to ourselves and we are quite easily offended by the others. Well, here's Jesus, according to the Matthew chapter 21. at the temple, ministering to the others. But we see what Jesus approached those people and he kicked them out. And I'm wondering, now, if we kick out of the temple, if we kicked out of the church so easily, maybe it's because we deserve it. Maybe this is a special wake-up call from God that will help us to make a new start. If we stand in front of His presence, absolutely naked in our soul, we'll ask Him to forgive us and to help us and to help us repent in our sins and be ready for His kingdom, which He is preparing for us. In order for us to do so, Renji White is giving us quite precious advice here. In the Book of Desire of Ages, page 175, it says, "The light shining from the cross reveals the love of God. His love is drawing us to Himself. And if we do not resist His drawing, we'll be led to the foot of the cross in repentance for the sins that have crucified the Savior." And now this world is collapsing, completely collapsing. This is why the Bible is advising us. Today, our verses from 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 is telling us the following words. What we need to be sober. It means open-minded and be watchful, because your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Let us continue to look up the cross, my dear friends. Let us see Jesus on the cross, who is suffering there for you and me. And if the Lord allows for this virus to be all over around the world, it's so obvious that there is a great lesson which the Lord is trying to give you and me. What life is very fragile and very precious. But we need to remember that this virus is not the end. We can all come in our struggles to the Lord, and we will be out of our struggles, and it will be stronger when we completely will rely on His word and pray to the Lord continually. Let us continue to pray and reach out for our brethren and sisters in Christ. And let us continue to encourage each other as we will go through this time together as a loving family in our special community. May God bless you, my dear friend. May God bless each of you, and especially bless your families in a time like this. Let me pray. Merciful Heavenly Father, we need you. We need your mercy. We need your forgiveness. Help us to accept your mercy and help us to accept your forgiveness and rethink our way of living. And as you will return us back to the church, help us to be more diligent. Help us to study more of your word and be faithful until you come to take us home. And now to Him who is able to keep you from failing and to bring you faultless and joyful before His glorious presence, to the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, let Him be the glory, majesty, might, and authority from all ages, past and now, and forever and ever. Amen.
Now we live.
is love, and we knew too. If you will let him do for you what he has done for me, he'll take away your sin and give you peace within. Oh, precious love of God, so rich and free. And it is broader than any sea. The love of Jesus took him to Calvary to suffer there for you. How sweet to walk each day, knowing he's there always, assured his love doth satisfy. Oh, sinner, heed his call, make him way. His love is deeper than any ocean, and it is broader than any sea. The love of Jesus took him to Calvary to suffer.